In becoming a better alternative for expats than the Philippines. In all honesty, I've spoken to, I think it's 4 or 5 people now that are looking at or going to retire here in Spain rather than the Philippines now. But I will also say that there are Gordon and May are here. May's from the Philippines. We've got other people that have come out of the UK. Brian's come out of the UK to Spain. We've got just down the road here, we've got Andreas and his wife. We've got a growing community of people that are coming out. And the funny thing is, all this Brexit stuff, they've been saying how the numbers are declining. I would disagree. In all honesty, I actually find that it would be very difficult for the true numbers of people that live in Spain to be really known. Because a lot of people have expired paperwork. A lot of people aren't registered as being here to avoid tax and don't bother with the healthcare and everything else. There is a huge number of people that simply do not exist from the UK in Spain. It's why they've started tightening up a bit, because I assume the UK is asking as well. But in all honesty, I don't think the UK or Spain really knows how many expats are here. But why would it be a better alternative than the Philippines? Well, I would have to say that the majority of people in some form originally go out to the Philippines to retire and meet somebody. The majority are like single males, looking for a partner. I mean, you don't come across many Western couples retiring in the Philippines, let's put it that way. It's normally a guy looking for a partner. From that social aspect, I would say it is very easy in the Philippines. In Spain, once you get to know the locals, yeah, but are you going to find somebody, in many people's cases, that's 10, 20 years younger than them or more? Probably not. And that's the clincher for a lot of people, is they actually want a new partner. So that's what the Philippines has as a positive. Cost of living. As a single person, I would say that the Philippines is a little bit, well, it's a bit more expensive than it used to be. It used to be, you could probably easily live on 20,000 pesos going back a bit. And I say that because I know a lot of people go, oh yeah, but I don't need this, I don't need this. I'm talking about you could actually reasonably live without, with getting everything you want. You know, having a motorbike or a car, having a reasonable standard of living. But I'm finding the costs are going up. The inflation is a problem with the Philippines, and especially if you've got the exchange rates affecting your pension. Now here in Europe, same problem though, with the euro v pound. We lost about 15% on the pound in the last year since the Brexit thing. But I would say that we generally can afford it. There's a lot of stuff people don't realise that, I'll keep the camera this way, keep the light on it. For example, wine is dirt cheap, beer is dirt cheap in Spain. I think the tariff of tax on wine for the UK is like £3. Doesn't sound a lot, but if you're having like 2-3 bottles of wine a week, or in some cases a lot more, it soon adds up. The same with, I suppose, cigarettes are cheaper. I don't know, I don't smoke. But I mean, wine here you can get from 40-50 cents upwards a litre. You can take a jug and refill it. I mean, that's one of the things they've got here. The UK, I can see, is already feeling the pinch of the Brexit. I think it was Dispatches this week did a video relating to the supermarkets and how they're sort of fudging the figures a little bit. You know, like when they have a pack of sausages, they're actually, the price might be the same, but there's like, say, 2 sausages less in the pack.
fish fingers, same. They took some fish fingers out of the box. It used to be 12 or whatever, and now it's 10. But it's the same price, because what they're trying to do is make it look like everything's normal. Reality is, I think the average food bill will probably end up going up at least 8% in the UK. The only downside in the UK is work. Work's hard to come by if you're not fluent in Spanish. Ideally, you want to be multilingual. If you're multilingual in this area, you've got no problem finding work. It's needed everywhere. But for me, it's also the commute. I can commute to the UK, which is ideal. Once I get April's paperwork done, that opens up a lot more opportunities for me and for her. Because April will start working soon. And then, obviously, I can commute a bit more. And then we'll be buying our house here. Well, I say house, we're probably going to buy an apartment. There's another reason. A lot of the apartments have come down in price in our area. I assume because of the Brexit thing, but also they're still building new properties, which means the older ones are getting cheaper, I suppose, because a lot of the new ones have in-house financing. So there's a lot of things like that which have a positive reason to move to Spain, because you can get property cheaper. We're looking at a three-bedroomed apartment with a car park, underground car park space, garage, underground car park garage, because it's even got its own up and over door. That's 80,000. Two beds, we've seen some cheap ones around now. Prices have started to come down a lot. The one we're interested in now dropped 10,000 euros in a year. Now, although that's 10,000, once we're ready, we'll make a final offer and come in under what they want and then meet somewhere in the middle. So that'll be probably a total of 15k off last year. That's the realities. It's a buyer's market. Well, what happens if they revoke the pensions for UK people? I don't think they're going to do that. The reason they won't do that, because it doesn't affect Europe. It's global. You'd have expats coming in from everywhere. You've got to remember, the EU side of it's only a small piece of where the expats are. Although there's a lot of expats here, there's expats in India, the Philippines, and everywhere else. If you start messing around with the pensions, they're all going to head west, and they're all going to sit on benefits in many cases, because the reason they went east or wherever is for cheaper cost of living. If they can't afford to live on their pensions, they're going to need accommodation for a start, because the houses and stuff they sold up to move overseas, they can't afford to buy back. They can't buy a place in the UK anymore. So I don't think pensions are going to get touched. The healthcare side, I think there'll be a negotiation with Spain and other countries which have a lot of the bilateral agreements, because Spain's already got a bilateral agreement with the UK relating to many things. So I don't think a lot of that's going to get touched. I think all that happen is a change of heads on the paper and a change of signatures, because it's beneficial to everybody. So there's a lot of reasons Spain is still a great place to live, but the Philippines, what lets it down, I would say the healthcare, it's not as good as it could be. I would say that before anybody bashes me on it, there's been a brain drain on the healthcare system for a long time. And it's nowhere on par with what we have in Spain or the UK. Well, more importantly, the quality of service is nowhere on par. You could probably get similar types of operations, but I wouldn't say the quality is at the same level. Because where you have state pension, state medical systems here that are sort of like a bottomless pit financially, in the Philippines, it's all about the money. like I was saying with my father-in-law, to get into ICU, we had to pay 30,000 euros up front. 30,000 pesos up front. And then that got him in the door. This is him getting admitted into the hospital. He's got his full health like everybody else, but they still wanted 30,000, because that doesn't let you into the ICU unit. That sort of thing is where the Philippines is a bit risky. In Spain, there's a royal decree, which sometimes get added and removed, that healthcare will be provided. They may bill you back at some point, but they will save your life as well. That is a better system, in my viewpoint. I know they often get people that don't pay, the same as the UK does, what they call the benefit tourists. But I don't know how big that problem is in reality. I think obesity is probably a bigger problem in the UK. Alcoholism will be a bigger problem. Deaths from smoking is a bigger problem. A lot of the problems in the UK revolve around the media focusing on this problem instead of this problem. Because obviously this problem affects more people, which means that might affect the people that read your newspaper or watch your news channel. So they don't really want to talk about those too much. But yeah, I recommend Spain. And although we're 90% through our immigration process of being 100% resident, we're then on the run to becoming full-blown citizens for April and the kids. The UK is just not for my family. I'll be blunt with it. I don't see the UK as multicultural friendly. I don't see it as somewhere I want my kids to be brought up. And it's not that I'm anti-British or something. Things have just changed over the last 10 years. Not just in the country, but obviously I've spent more time overseas and you can see a lot more things. And I've got to admit, I'm not PC. I don't agree with the old PC nonsense. And I do think the PC nonsense is part to blame for what's going on in the UK. But the media is also just playing people off each other like no tomorrow, just to sell whatever they can. And that, I think that's where the problems are in the UK. People need to start researching things themselves a bit more and realising a lot of times that they've been told stuff that is even proven it's fake. But in my mindset, Spain offers a better alternative on so many levels. I'm sat here now, sun's out, I'm actually getting hot in the car, and we're still in February. Thanks for watching.